Hi, everybody. I noticed, I'm sorry if we didn't weren't able to get to all the questions. Okay, fantastic. If you need more, if you have some questions for the sleep physician, she's outside. Okay, wonderful. I have the biography. I'm very excited to introduce our next speaker. I'd like to introduce Dr. Carrie Knievel. A neurologist, professor of neurology, and director of the Lewis Headache Center at Barrow Neurological Institute. She is licensed through the Arizona Board of Osteopathic Medical Examiners and board certified in neurology by the American Board of Psychiatry and Neurology and in headache medicine by the United Council for Neurological Subspecialties. Dr. Knievel's areas of interest include headaches and neuromuscular diseases. She is a member of the American Academy of Neurology, American Headache Society, and American Society of Neuromuscular and Electrodiagnostic Medicine. Dr. Knievel received her doctorate of osteopathic medicine from Kirksville College of Osteopathic Medicine in Kirksville, Missouri. She completed her residency in neurology at Barrow Neurological Institute, where she also completed a neuromuscular fellowship. She is our expert today in headaches. So let's give her a nice round of applause. Thank you very much.
Good morning, everyone. So I run the headache program here. Even though my training was initially in neuromuscular, I quickly switched to headache and now really do mostly headache. I see headache patients in the clinic, and we manage headache in the hospital. And we have 8 other providers that work with me to see headache patients. So we have quite a large multidisciplinary center here that we're really proud of, that includes psychologists, social workers, 4 physical therapists actually, and soon a sleep neurologist who just preceded me. And then we work closely with the pituitary center as well, as would kind of make sense. So I'm going to be talking about headache. I'm going to leave plenty of time for questions. And if anyone has like a burning question that really, really relates right in the middle, perfect. If not, let's try to save questions till the end because I will leave plenty of time. Okay, let's get started. So I just want to kind of give like the lay of the land of what I'm going to talk about. I'm going to talk about what happens in a pituitary tumor, why does it cause headache? Sometimes it's we don't know, sometimes we do know. And then I'm going to talk about kind of our approach to a patient with headache, whether they have pituitary tumor or whether they don't, because sometimes patients present to us and it's actually the headache that leads us in the headache program to discover their pituitary tumor. And then we would refer to the pituitary program. Sometimes it's the other way. So I'm going to talk about kind of the history that we take when we meet a patient for the first time, and then how we reach the diagnosis and when some other testing might need to be done. And then I'm going to talk about some of our treatment approaches. So I'm going to talk much, much less about hormonal treatments. I'm going to talk more about headache-specific treatments. I'm sure you've heard more about the hormone treatments and other topics, and that's out of my specialty anyway. So just some stats. 70% of patients with pituitary tumors have some sort of headache. It's not necessarily and sometimes surprising to me correlated with tumor size. I've seen some scans in patients who really have no headaches at all and they have very, very large tumor, and some where it's even really kind of questionable whether there's a tumor there at all versus an artifact when reviewing the scan, and this patient has significant headache. The causality meaning is, I think this is actually the most important bullet point, the one that says causality. Is the tumor causing the headache? There's a lot of other things that can cause headache. For example, migraine affects about 15% of the population, and sometimes pituitary lesions are incidentally discovered in scans for other type of headache. So it doesn't necessarily matter in every single way, but it is pretty important to know whether the tumor is causing the headache, but sometimes it can actually be really, really hard for us to tell. A pituitary tumor can cause a worsening of a baseline headache. So if someone has had migraine headaches since childhood or since they were a teenager, One of the things that can cause an increase in frequency, severity, for those headaches to become more refractory to treatment is something else going on, such as a pituitary tumor. This could also be someone with a new headache that looks just like migraine, looks just like a cluster headache that I'm going to talk about also. Brand new headache that looks like one of our primary headaches, which is a primary headache is a headache where there's nothing underlying causing it. It's due to an oversensitivity of nerves. But then sometimes they're on a scan, we find a pituitary lesion. Again, is it causal? Is it not? Not always clear. Surgery sometimes makes it better. Sometimes it worsens it. If there is a worsening of headache after surgery, it's usually transient. It's usually related to nerve irritation from the surgery itself. So other causes kind of peripherally related to acromegaly, but that can also contribute to headache, hypertension, high blood pressure. I'll just say sleep apnea. You just had a whole talk on it. Some people can get some arthritis of their neck and also the temporomandibular joint, the jaw, and that can contribute to headache as well, actually quite significantly. And then any kind of issues with sinus issues and then post-surgery pain. So this is a kind of the one of the largest studies in headache and acromegaly, and actually there aren't very many. There isn't a lot of literature on this, but this just shows that the tumor characteristics in this one particular study that has, you know, I'm going to go through kind of the characteristics of what the headache appeared like. So in this study, 28% of the patients had acromegaly of the patients that they reviewed. Okay, so I'm going to go through more of the features of their headache, but this is, let me just actually go through. So in the study, this is what the headaches looked like in patients. So of all the patients they looked at, 28% had acromegaly. So actually in headache with pituitary tumor, we very often see unilateral headache. And usually it's what's called side-locked, which means it stays on the right side, never jumps to the left. So that's most of the time what we see. It can go from one side to the other sometimes. Sometimes it can be unilateral, sometimes it can be bilateral, and it can kind of fluctuate. But it's actually more rare that it's just bilateral and equal, which I found really interesting. I do see in my clinic that it is often unilateral, or at least unilateral predominant. But I was really surprised in this study to actually see that it was a very small percentage with perfectly unilateral symmetric headache. And then the locations there are at the bottom, around the eyes, behind the eyes, more in the front. And then this was looking at the intensity and the quality of the headache. Never mild, unfortunately. So most commonly severe and occasionally excruciating, and the excruciating headaches are usually a headache type called trigeminal autonomic cephalgia. That's how we would diagnose it from a headache vantage point, and I'll talk about that later also. And the quality of headache, most commonly throbbing, and actually throbbing is the most common headache quality of migraine as well. So you can kind of see why this can be a little bit tricky. There's lots of other things that can cause a sharp headache as well. Some people experiencing kind of a stabbing pain as well. And often that stabbing pain is around the eye or in the temple. And then this looks at just duration of the headache, frequency of the headache. Median duration was 7 hours. Often people have a persistent headache. Sometimes people have a persistent baseline headache with superimposed headache attacks on top of that. Sometimes people do have headache-free time. The associated symptoms listed there, nausea, vomiting, and light sensitivity, that's photophobia, and then smell sensitivity. Those are the hallmarks of migraine, which is another reason why this is difficult to discern. Then at the bottom, the cranial autonomic symptoms. Those are the features of the trigeminal autonomic cephalgia type headaches, such as cluster headache, if some of you have heard of those. Those types of headaches, we always consider evaluating for pituitary lesions because they can most commonly present with that type of headache. I'm just gonna go back to this other slide. The usual features that I see. So it can be kind of fluctuating. Like I said, it can be, usually it's just kind of, people start to notice a little headache, kind of increases in frequency, kind of fluctuates. They think, is it my sinuses? Is it allergies? Is it something else? And then, like I said, most commonly it's actually more in that green zone here, kind of around the eyes, forehead, and kind of behind the eyes. And more of a throbbing, aching, deep, sharp, sometimes stabbing pain. And then it could involve the midface too, that pink area. Again, some people think it's related to their eyes if it's in the green area. Some people think it's and are pretty sure it's their sinuses if it involves the pink area. And unfortunately, some people get sinus surgery before their proper headache diagnosis is made, which can often make it worse. So why would a pituitary tumor cause pain? There's a lot of potential reasons. Sometimes I think it's a combination of these. People with migraine, which I said is 15% of the population, have at baseline an oversensitivity of their nerves. So the sensory nerves of the face, head, and brain, and those pathways are kind of closer to a threshold where they would become activated and start a headache. It can happen completely spontaneously. It can happen on a rainy day like today, where barometric pressure changes are happening. And sometimes other people find other triggers. So if someone has that kind of baseline predisposition, perhaps they're more sensitive to something else abnormal in their head. But even if they don't, the mechanical pressure, just actual pressure of that mass on the dura, which is highly sensitive and innervated, can cause headache. And then hormone excretion can cause headache as well. And sometimes I'm sure you both know, you all know way better than I do that hormone treatment can fix headache. Surgical treatment can sometimes fix headache. So that biochemical activation of the sensory nerves as well. Then there's something called central sensitization. And I think this is a very interesting concept. And I think it's important to understand. So this is basically, this can happen peripherally too. So the peripheral sensory nerves are the branches of the trigeminal nerves and then some of the occipital nerves in the back of the head. But as it relates to the pituitary, more trigeminal nerve branches, they innervate the face, the area around the eyes, the sinuses, the upper teeth, but also the dura, the meninges, the coverings over the brain. If those are persistently activated, say an untreated headache or headache that has a continuous stimulus, such as a pituitary lesion and abnormal hormones, it can actually cause those nerves and the central sensory pathways of the brain to stay in an on state where even after surgery, even after treatment of hormone levels by Dr. Ewan and his crew, the headache can actually persist, and that can be because those sensory pathways are just stuck in the on state, and we call that central sensitization. So I know that's kind of a complex thought, but some of the treatments that we use in my program are to help with that. So that's something that we consider in patients who we think have been completely treated but still have relatively persistent or relatively frequent headaches. The cavernous sinus can be involved, and that's where that V1 and V2 branch of the trigeminal nerve, that green and pink area on that diagram, cavernous sinus is just lateral to the cella, so there can be pressure there and actually just direct pressure on those nerves. Stress and anxiety are common in chronic health conditions, common in frequent headaches. It's people are concerned about when their next headache is coming on, and the kind of psychological trauma brings anxiety and depression very, very commonly. And I already talked about the other two. So here's these nerves that I've been talking about. So this is a cross section of the brain. This is the dura. So this is zoomed in on this dura covering over the brain right here. There's blood vessels in the dura, but there's also these sensory nerves. And then they come into the brain through the brainstem and activate central processes in the brain. So when these stay in the on state, you can get peripheral and central sensitization. And here's our area of interest here. These pathways go right in that area. This isn't perfectly to scale, but. And here's the cella, and here's the cavernous sinus where those sensory nerves are. So you could get compression on the dura. You could get compression on the proximal parts of those nerves as well. Just kind of a side note, pituitary apoplexy. When And this is something that I occasionally see in the hospital. So we're called to the emergency room. Someone's come in with a very sudden onset of a headache. We ask every patient whether they have thunderclap headache, a headache that comes on like a lightning bolt, comes on very suddenly, and is 10 out of 10 in intensity in less than a minute, but actually usually just a few seconds. They often have significant nausea and vomiting. And so one of the things we think about with this thunderclap type of headache is an aneurysm rupture and subarachnoid hemorrhage. But with in the setting of vision loss, double vision, stiffness of the neck, and sometimes fever, one of the other things that we think about is pituitary apoplexy, and it's seen on a scan. So headache associated specifically with acromegaly, like I said, can respond to surgery, but often there's some residual headache, and like I said, occasionally a transient worsening of headache. Sometimes there's absolutely no change with headache, and there's really no way to predict what's going to happen. Sometimes hormone treatments are used. So we actually, in our program, look at the type of headache. And so we use diagnostic classification to figure out the type of headache that is consistent with our patient, and then use associated and appropriate preventative and acute treatments for those. So I'm going to kind of go over those now. This is the sort of Bible of headache neurology, the International Headache Classification. So this is where we get the diagnostic criteria. This is updated every few years. So this is from that another study, or that study that I cited earlier. These were the headache diagnoses most commonly seen in patients with pituitary tumor: chronic migraine, and then episodic migraine. So the difference between episodic and chronic migraine is episodic migraine is headaches on fewer than 15 days per month, and chronic is headache on greater than 15 days per month, up to daily and persistent headache. The next three diagnoses, one called SUNCT, cluster headache, and hemicrania continua, those are all those trigeminal autonomic cephalgia type headaches. Those are the ones that are usually a more sharp pain around the eye, with stabbing around the eye and in the temple, usually always on one side. And on the same side as the headache, people can have a drooping eyelid, tearing of their eye, sometimes nose congestion or runny nose. And I'll talk about those a little bit more later. And then a primary stabbing headache, which is stabbing without any other of those features. And then there's some, you know, there's always other category. So the diagnostic criteria for migraine: at least 5 attacks. Everyone has their first 4 migraines, right? Lasting 4 to 72 hours usually, and that's if left untreated. Certainly it can last longer, but if it's longer than 72 hours, it's then called status migrainosis. And then 2 of the following characteristics. So just 2 out of the 4, unilateral or unilateral predominant, more of a pulsating quality, more on the moderate to severe side, and certainly that's subjective. And then worsened with physical activity. Some people feel better very, very still. Some people feel better laying down. So usually these are people who are not going to want to take the stairs, go to the gym, et cetera. So just 2 of those features is required. And then the most important, actually, for distinguishing for us is letter D, nausea and vomiting. So that nausea, it doesn't need to be like food poisoning nausea, vomiting. It can be like this queasiness. You just don't really feel like eating, but you might still eat, but you just kind of feel queasy and yucky. And if there is truly no nausea, then both light and sound sensitivity are required to make the diagnosis. And there's actually a category E in every single diagnosis of the International Headache Society criteria, which is not attributed to another disorder. So it's basically like, hey, doctor, look at the big picture. Is there anything else that could be going on with this patient? Are they having other associated symptoms? Are there any red flags for evaluation of a secondary headache? Is this a brand new headache in someone who's 60 years old, much less likely to be migraine, et cetera? Just a couple of differences with migraine with aura. Aura affects about 30% of people with migraine. So the aura is most commonly visual. Usually it's actually just a black or white spot that sort of follows through the vision. And it can be actually kind of squiggly lines, usually in like the outer part of the visual field. They can be colorful, they can be bright, they can be flashing, they can be squiggly lines. Sometimes people have numbness, speech difficulties, and sometimes people even have aura that are that is associated with weakness. So the aura would start and progress over about 5 minutes and then last a total of 5 to 60 minutes and usually proceed or come on just as the headache pain is starting. So often these are quite scary the first few times it happens to patients. This is commonly seen in the emergency room, concern for TIA and stroke. But when associated with a migraine type headache, it's much less concerning. Certainly we look at other risk factors as well for stroke. So here's the, just pictures of what some of the auras really look like. Sometimes they can be very pronounced and quite scary. Sometimes they can really impede vision. I mean, people, if they start to get them, have to kind of pull off to the side of the road. I talked about chronic migraine. It can be with or without aura. This is very debilitating, as you can imagine. A staggering statistic, though, is that 1% of the population has chronic migraine. So 1% of people have migraine on at least 15 days out of the month, and many of those are much more frequent than that. This is also important to, I think this is very important, actually. I think this really shows some good information. I think this is really insightful. It shows us how debilitating migraine can be and for how long. So we've talked about the aura phase, we've talked about the migraine attack phase in the center of this bell curve, but before and after are phases called prodrome and postdrome. And look at the very top, how long they can last, hours to days. So before a headache attack, and some people can really start to identify this, they get a little bit irritable, some people start yawning more, feel fatigued or just yawn, increased thirst, increased urination. There's different reasons for that in this room. I totally get it. But thinking about this, food craving, increased light sensitivity, nausea, this prodrome can last quite a while. So a difficulty with cognition and thought processing is another thing that occurs during this phase. So this can be debilitating in itself. And then in the postdrome, there's inability to concentrate and fatigue as well. So if you look, one migraine attack can affect someone for the better part of a week, if not even a whole week. And so if someone has 4 migraine attacks per month, they're always in one of these phases, which means they're always not completely functioning to their full potential, which is why we use preventive treatments for migraine attacks, and we use aggressive acute treatments to stop headache as soon as possible. And in fact, we have new treatments that can actually be taken if a patient can accurately identify this prodrome phase with reliability. There's even medications now that can treat before the headache attack starts and actually prevent the headache attack from ever starting or significantly shorten its duration. Speaking of acute treatments, just the kind of overall general rules with acute treatment, they should be taken at the onset of a migraine attack. And I know this is difficult for people sometimes to figure out. If someone has rare headache attacks, they know when it's starting. They go from feeling good to feeling bad, and some people know when it's coming. But for people with chronic and persistent headaches, sometimes it's not completely obvious. Certainly we do other things to try and stop or prevent or lessen the persistent headache. But even for people with persistent headache, if they have time when the intensity is increasing or changing, that would be when to use an acute treatment. And it is different for every patient. So it really does require a conversation with each individual patient to identify when to use this. But the ultimate is, don't wait and see if it gets worse. Don't wait till it gets really bad. Don't eat a banana and rub something on your forehead unless you know that something like that's going to work. I hear so many interesting things that people try before they're taking their acute treatment. But it's really important because the acute treatments only have receptors for their effects outside the brain. And when migraine starts, it starts in the nerves outside the brain, but then spreads inside the brain. So the sooner you take it, the better, because you want to catch it before it basically, this is a little simplified, but before it gets inside the brain where the medication can't get to it anymore. It's kind of how I think about it. Usually we use a class of medications called triptans. These are several different medications, Imitrex or Sumatriptan, Rizatriptan. There's many different ones, and they've been out since the 90s, and they were really revolutionary when they came out because they were the first migraine-specific treatment. Some people's migraines respond to over-the-counter medications, NSAIDs, Tylenol, things like that. And if that works and it's very infrequent, that's okay. But for the most part, the type of patients that we're seeing in our program, that doesn't work for them. Or if they use those medications too frequently, it can actually increase the frequency of headaches. There's another medication called dihydroergotamine, and that's a really old medication actually, but it can still work very well. And it actually does cross that blood-brain barrier a little bit. So we can use it for headaches that have been going on longer periods of time. And it's specifically one of the treatments that we use for status migrainosis, which is the migraine lasting greater than 72 hours. Those two medications, the DHE and any of the triptans, can't be used within 24 hours of each other. And they're also can't be used in people who have high blood pressure that's not controlled, heart disease, history of stroke, et cetera. The bullet point down here, we use nasal in kind of nasal sprays or sub-Q injections for people who wake up with headache or have rapid headache onset or who have lots of nausea, because that can help actually with delivering the medication more quickly. And you know, if you take a pill and have nausea, you actually get reduced absorption. Certainly if you have vomiting, you're going to have massively reduced absorption, right? Sometimes we combine therapy, and then there's this new class of medications that I'll talk about. There's two. One is called the DITANs, and one is called the GPANTS. So I have them listed here. So these are the new medications that we have. These have been out for a couple years to 5 years. Ubrelvy and Nurtec are the ones that I use most. They're in the GPANT class. They actually block this nerve transmitter called CGRP that's released by those sensory nerves. This is a DHE that's inhaled through the nose. And this is something called Reyvow, which is essentially works like one of those triptan medications, but doesn't have any effect on the blood vessels. So that's a triptan-like medication that's safe for people with cardiovascular disease. So for people who have more than 4 headache days per month is what the American Headache Society classification or guidelines would say, need preventive treatment. If people don't have good response to their acute treatment, sometimes I will start patients on preventive treatment sooner, and even with fewer headaches than 4 per month. If each headache lasts 4 days and we can't find something that will break it more quickly, some of those people, then I would also start them on a preventive treatment. So the old stuff that we used to always use that we still use sometimes and I still get some benefit with, seizure medications, blood pressure medications, and antidepressant medications can be helpful. And then Botox can be used for chronic migraine. That's been approved by the FDA since 2010, and the injections are done around the head, I'll show you. There's medications called that block CGRP. They're monoclonal antibodies, once a month injected. And then there's those oral medications, Nurtec, and another one called Qulipta, that are actually daily medications for prevention. And then there's some other devices that can be used that are kind of attached to the head, neurostimulator devices. And there's some others that can be actually quite helpful. Nerve blocks are something else, blocking with local anesthesia, local anesthetic, the occipital nerve and some of the branches of the trigeminal nerve can be very helpful as well. So here's the CGRP monoclonal antibodies, Aimovig, Emgality, and Ajovy are across the top here. Nurtec and Qulipta. So Nurtec can be used both for prevention and for acute treatment. And then Qulipta is another medication that's taken daily for prevention. So the bottom are pills, the top three are just roughly monthly injections. So I talked about when to use prevention. So with frequent headaches that don't respond well to acute treatments, or maybe you just haven't found an acute treatment yet for the patient that works well, worsening of frequency of headache. So perhaps when headache frequency, if someone has a history of migraine, their migraine frequency increases associated with pituitary tumor or surgery or whatever, that might be a great time for us to institute preventive treatment. Some people have what really, really looks like migraine headache. and they've never had a migraine before. Maybe they had one when they were younger or something. But some people, it just takes that much insult to the nerves to really bring out that type of headache when they have the genetic predisposition. So I guess what I'm trying to say with that is, even if you've never had a migraine headache in the past, if your headache associated with pituitary tumor looks like migraine, that's how we're still going to treat it. Other times we use prevention are, so what I mean by the second to last bullet point is some people, based on their profession, what they do, they can't tolerate even a couple of hours here and there of a migraine attack. So for some of those patients, you know, I have some surgeons and other people who really, really can't have even a headache that responds within 2 hours to a treatment. Sometimes I would start those patients on preventive treatments as well. And then for people who have medication overuse headache, which is a headache that we think might be increasing in frequency because of usually over-the-counter medication use. So we would start those patients on prevention while adjusting their acute treatments. So this is where we do the occipital nerve blocks. If I were left with only one treatment for headache, it would be this. It can work to break a long-standing headache, and it can also work for prevention of headache. And it has very minimal side effects. We don't have to worry about it with cardiovascular disease, et cetera. Even if someone's on a blood thinner, this injection is just under the skin, over the greater occipital nerve, and there's some other nerves in the back of the head that we can block, most commonly the greater occipital nerve. So it has projections up and over the head and actually to areas behind the eyes. So it can help with pain in the front of the head, even though the nerve is in the back of the head. Sometimes we block other branches of the trigeminal nerve, also using lidocaine or usually marcaine, and it's just injected under the skin. This is called a sphenopalatine ganglion block. It's something else that we actually do in our clinic, and it's through the nose. There's a ganglion, which is a cluster of sensory nerve cells just behind the nose, and there's a thin layer of bone back there where the lidocaine that we drip into the nose can actually diffuse through. And how all of these procedures work, where we're basically bathing a nerve with local anesthetic, we think that they actually stop the nerve's ability to propagate an impulse. They'll make your head go numb for a little bit. And then when those nerves essentially wake up and feeling comes back about 8 or so hours later, we hope that it kind of resets the threshold of those nerves and those sensory pathways for activation. So it can work for breaking a headache, but also kind of reprogramming those nerves a little bit for headache prevention. These are the locations that Botox is injected. Botox actually works on the sensory nerve system. We always tend to think about it working on muscles when used for cosmetic purposes or for spasticity, but we inject it into muscles so that we make sure that the symmetry of the face and eyebrows, et cetera, is preserved. But we're really injecting around those sensory nerve branches. So the same nerves that we kind of block, you can actually see the greater occipital nerve area and then some of the areas of the very upper neck. So we're targeting sensory nerves. And Botox actually prevents release of that CGRP that's important in migraine, among other things. So let's talk briefly about the trigeminal autonomic cephalgias, which I've kind of alluded to before. These are, when I see a patient, a new patient in my clinic with headaches that look like trigeminal autonomic cephalgia, I always image them. I always do a brain MRI, and I always image their blood vessels, because blood vessels can, abnormalities can cause headaches like this too. And one of the things that I'm looking for on their imaging is a pituitary lesion. And I've seen it quite a few times. And if I have a high enough concern clinically, I would also check hormone levels and have Dr. Yuen see them. The most common subtype that we see is cluster headache, and the other subtypes are listed there. These are differentiated. It's not too important for you all to know the differentiation, because the treatments that I would use differ a little bit between these, but not actually too much. So how they differ is by the frequency of attacks and the duration of attacks. So the ones at the bottom are the shortest duration, and then hemicrania continua is actually a continuous headache on half of the head, and it can have more pain around the eye. It can have some increase in kind of spikes in headache, and it can have eyelid droop and eyelid tearing, et cetera. Cluster headache being the most common, it lasts between a half an hour and an hour and a half or a little bit more. And it often happens at night. And one of the features of these headaches too is that whereas with migraine, remember I said activity worsens the headache and those patients want to be still, they want to be lying down, they want to be in bed. With this headache, they're often up and moving around, rocking back and forth, hitting on their head. I actually had a patient with this was banging their head on the wall and actually damaged the drywall. So these people are moving, not always, but that is one of the features that can happen. And that's one of the things that we use to help differentiate. So here's the list of in yellow here of all of these cranial autonomic features. Those are that's the trigeminal autonomic cephalgia. So you can get redness of the eye, that's conjunctival injection. You can get tearing, nasal congestion, and then runny nose. These are all on the same side as the pain, or at least asymmetric to higher on that side. Swelling of the eyelid, redness of the eyelid, you can get sweating or redness of that entire side of the face. And this is during the headache. You can get eyelid droop and then that sense of restlessness or agitation, which can be mild. It can be an inner sense or it can be very, very outward. This can happen, it's all frequent, every other day to even up to 8 per day or more. Usually happens at night. This is actually one of the few headaches that's more common in men than women. This is what it feels like. So the reason it's called cluster headache is because they cluster seasonally, often around February or the fall, but it doesn't really matter. Patients will often find that there's a certain season of the year where they come on. And they often occur at night, and they often awaken people from sleep. And it can actually cause fear of going to sleep because of the concern that this headache is going to come on. Lots of different prevention treatments that we can use, prevention than acute treatments, verapamil, a blood pressure medication. There's actually some other medications that can be used for prevention. The rescue treatment, when the headache starts, the abortive treatment, we want to use the nasal or the injectable triptans because they get to this headache much more quickly. An oxygen rebreather at a very high flow rate can actually help for stopping this type of headache. And then Emgality, the same medication, galcanezumab, that we talked about for migraine prevention at a different dose can actually stop a cluster headache attack cycle too. Sprays of lidocaine in the nose, steroid tapers, and then here it is again, the occipital nerve block, except for we usually add a little bit of steroid to the occipital nerve block for treatment of cluster headache. Hemicrania continua, I'm just going to talk about this really briefly. This is a continuous pain on half of the head. Literally, if you dissect the Latin here, half of the head, continuous pain for at least 3 months to make this diagnosis. So often that is what people with pituitary tumor experience. Hemicrania continua is a pure primary headache, but pituitary tumor is one of the things that we look for when we see this semiology. The treatment for this is a medication called indomethacin, and it's actually part of the diagnostic criteria that it would respond to this. This is a very specific type of NSAID, different than the NSAIDs that would be over-the-counter, like ibuprofen, et cetera. It can help dramatically with this type of headache, as long as someone's stomach can tolerate it. Melatonin is another treatment that can work well for this type of headache and sometimes the other trigeminal autonomic cephalgias. So some other things that we look at, just lifestyle. Managing mental health, managing physical health, managing sleep. I don't need to talk about that. We utilize physical therapy quite a bit, managing the neck muscles, the skull base, posture. I think that's very important for headaches, sleep position, pillows, et cetera. Exercise is important, whatever exercise can be done. Hydration, healthy diet, eating regular meals, et cetera, is super important for headache prevention and overall control. I talked about medication overuse headache a little bit. Here's the frequency that we start to worry about that in days of use per month. So typically what we would do to manage this is stop the overused medications. Sometimes we use a taper of steroid. I would always consult with the endocrinologist before doing something like that. And we use nerve blocks. There they are again. And then initiating a preventive treatment when stopping the medication, but then finding another acute treatment to help that patient. So just an overall summary. Certainly if a pituitary tumor is discovered, whether Incidentally, in the workup for headache or otherwise, medical surgical treatment is of course necessary, but from my standpoint, we look at which primary headache disorder does this mimic and treat it accordingly. Early treatment is important, especially early preventive treatment, if headache frequency is increasing or already high. And then early treatment of each individual headache attack with an acute treatment is important also to avoid all of the comorbidities that can come along with headache, but also that sensitization that we talked about. And then also just that the pain often persists after treatment, and that can be related to sensitization. It can be related to a lot of different things, but that's what we're managing in our program. And then we avoid opiates and Fiorasate or barbiturates for treatment of headache virtually whenever possible. I think I have just a couple of patients on these, and there is a very, very specific reason. But now with the new medications that we have available that don't put people with cardiovascular risk at higher risk, we almost always have other options for treating patients. This is a couple years ago, so we actually have way more people in our program now, but you can kind of see the number of people that we have working together. Thank you. I'll take questions.
Great talk, yes, Carrie. Quick question about, given the audience of acromegaly, is there any data on the effectiveness of the use or how frequently can one consider using the nerve blocks, particularly Botox with patients with acromegaly?
How frequent?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And how effective is as well?
How effective, yeah. Boy, it really depends on the patient. Botox can be quite beneficial. We inject it every 12 weeks and never more frequently than that, because rarely antibodies can develop against Botox, but it's also, we don't want to have increased muscle weakness, and we can get kind of brow drooping and eyelid drooping if it's done too frequently. So we just do it every 12 weeks. I do see benefit with that. It tends to occur a little bit more slowly than with nerve blocks, but really we start to see a benefit even within the first month. And usually we see the majority of the maximum benefit after two injection cycles. So that's, you know, one injection, 3 months later, the second injection, and then give that some time to work. So really in about 6 months. But the majority of that benefit occurs within the first month or two. So never think, oh, I'm getting Botox, I have to wait 6 months for it to work. And then with nerve blocks, the effect can be usually more immediate. The head goes numb. Sometimes people say, my head is numb, but I still feel like it hurts on the inside. And sometimes that can get better over a few days. Sometimes the nerve block can actually trigger a headache. And if we treat that, then it'll kind of stay away. Sometimes the first nerve block works for a week or two. And then doing another one and maybe doing them a little bit more frequently at the beginning can actually be more beneficial. Everyone is different, though. I also have quite a few patients that I see every couple of years, and I do a nerve block and then they do great. One headache occurring after a nerve block or Botox certainly doesn't mean that it's failing. We hope that it reduces the frequency, intensity, severity, and then improves the response to treatment. So that's it. We want to look at kind of overall the big picture when we're treating with anything preventive.
There we go. Thank you so much for this talk. But headache was actually what led to my MRI and my ultimate diagnosis. Not to dive too much into my history, but I have a VP shunt. But what are some like common symptoms that would point to hydrocephalus as the cause of this headache?
Yeah, that's tricky too. But with hydrocephalus, people can have difficulty with walking and urinary incontinence. Sometimes vision changes, sometimes depending on the type of hydrocephalus, you can have headache that's worse when you're lying flat, and sometimes it can awaken you from sleep. That's kind of main thing that we would look for. The scan is pretty telling though, usually.
I have a quick question. Well, maybe quick. I get ocular migraines. Is that like you said the aura, is that the same thing?
It's a little bit different. A lot of times the migraine with visual aura is called an ocular migraine. But pure ocular migraine is, there's also migraine visual aura without headache, but ocular migraine is a little bit different, affecting kind of just the vision. So is there headache with it? Okay. So that could be migraine aura without headache, probably most commonly, but we would always recommend an ophthalmologic evaluation for that also.
I was just wondering if it was possible to do the nerve block and the Botox.
No, because of insurance. Most of the time I try to only start one treatment at a time. Not that we start one treatment and wait an eternity to see if it's working, but if there are any side effects or even benefit, doing two treatments at the same time can kind of make it confusing. Would I love to, in a subset of patients, be able to use a nerve block to stop and break their headache and Botox on top of that, basically in someone who's been on Botox for a while? Absolutely. But for the most part, insurance prohibits that.
Thank you for this information. Super helpful. I was just curious, have you seen any correlation? Have you seen any correlation with trigeminal neuralgia, or is it more commonly one of these types of headaches?
More commonly the trigeminal autonomic cephalgia headaches. But they do, all these headache types overlap so much with their features. So sometimes it's not even clear which category within the ICHD-3 they're in, but the pain in trigeminal neuralgia is quite similar to actually the pain in trigeminal autonomic cephalgia. And some people don't really have that many of those autonomic features, but just having restlessness is actually enough. And in hemicrania continua, you need none of the autonomic features, but even if you have a pressure in your ear or something like that, it actually makes it meet the diagnostic criteria. And the other thing that we see is actually, and I ask patients about this and they're like, how did you know? It's actually foreign body sensation in their eye with a headache on half of their head can make that meet the diagnostic criteria for hemicrania continua. So I'm like, do you just always feel like you have like a piece of lint or eyelash in your eye? They're like, how do you know that? So trigeminal neuralgia is definitely separate. Trigeminal neuralgia is more commonly the lower face, and trigeminal autonomic cephalgia is more likely the upper face. That's one of the easiest ways to distinguish the two, but we do see both.
Mm-hmm. So we have a lot of patients that take instant octreotide to try to help their headaches. Mm-hmm. Do you have any experience with that?
I do, and it works really well for some people and not so well for others. There's actually studies in pure migraine, completely normal pituitary gland and normal pituitary hormones, but treating migraine with octreotide, and that can be quite helpful for people too. Definitely a helpful tool for some patients. Not usually the first thing I go to, but for the right patient, absolutely. Mm-hmm.
Hi, I just wondered if you could speak a little bit more to the, like, any biochemical causes of these. I had a 10-year, like 24/7 headache that was more like a hemicrania continua. Mm-hmm. But I saw 20 neurologists and they put me on every single one of those things that were up there, electric shocks, all the stuff. And nothing worked until somatuline, which regulated hormones. So to me that, and I don't have a tumor that's pressing on a nerve or a vessel. So to me, that shows that, you know, there's some chemical reaction going on that's irritating the nerves, the blood vessels, or something in some way that we don't fully understand.
That's exactly, you answer your own question. Don't fully understand.
My question is, because I've seen 20 neurologists and then a lot of them gaslit me, you know, is there anybody studying that interaction that you know of?
Not that I know of, but I'm sure there are people looking into it. Exactly why, and also why doesn't that necessarily correlate? There could be someone who presents just like you and has no headache, or their tumor looks the same and their hormone levels are just the same and they don't respond to hormone treatment. It's really, there's definitely a lot that's not understood, but it does seem that hormones can activate the pathway, The other big question in someone like you is, if your hormones are what's activating it, why is it only half of your head? Because the hormones are a more kind of systemic thing. If someone's pituitary lesion is more off to the right side and it's the right side of their head that hurts, we can kind of wrap our heads around that, right? But it's definitely something that we see, and no one really understands that either.
Yeah. So I've had a headache for 15 years, nonstop. When I go to the doctor, they tell me it's all in my head and prescribe antidepressants. It does get worse every so often. And when that happens, it's like I have a stroke face. The whole left side of my face droops. I've showed the doctors photos of this, and they tell me I'm imagining it. But I do have pictures here, if you wouldn't mind having a look maybe later. What could it be, or what could I ask?
Yeah, the pictures actually are super, super helpful to a headache specialist to see what it looks like during, what you look like during your headache. So, you know, without seeing them, you know, some of the time that can be one of the trigeminal autonomic cephalgias, and treating specifically with medications that help that type of headache. So I don't know if you're seeing a subspecialist in headache, but I think that would be helpful. A subspecialist in headache will want to see your pictures and will not gaslight you, and will say, this picture is super helpful, and your description of what you feel and what is happening is very, very helpful for me to make this diagnosis. And then they could use the treatments that I showed. And sometimes I get lucky and the very first treatment works amazingly well, and sometimes it's the fourth or fifth. Sometimes it's a combination of a few different ones, but I think there aren't too many patients that absolutely need a subspecialist neurologist in headache, but most migraine can actually be managed by primary care. But when it starts to get tricky with different symptoms like that, it's probably important to see a subspecialist.
I don't have a question, but I wanted to say thank you for your presentation, because the majority of people that I've met suffer from headaches, and we've all been told pituitary tumors don't cause headaches. So thank you for this.
Yeah.
Do you see any or many headaches that might be associated or present with orofacial pain, like, for example, diffuse pain across the molars, bilaterally, without any dental cause? Anything like orofacial pain plus headache?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Man, just when I think I've seen it all, I see something else. So yes, absolutely. You know, that could be a lot of different things. The trigeminal nerves run right through the sinuses into the upper jaw. And then, you know, the second trigeminal nerve to the upper jaw and sinuses, the third to the lower jaw. So whether migraine, activating that, anything with the jaw joint, the temporomandibular joint, or trigeminal neuralgia, it's often determined that, oh, well, if this part of my face hurts, it must be my sinus. If these teeth hurt, must be these teeth. And, you know, some people get jaw surgery, sinus surgery, tooth extractions. I've seen people with the whole top half of their teeth removed because of pain, assuming that the teeth must be it, but it's really trigeminal neuralgia. I've seen people with sinus surgeries, and sinus surgery often worsens migraine if it wasn't necessary. I've seen people with sinus surgery because of the trigeminal autonomic cephalgia type of headache, because they actually have nose congestion and fluid coming out of their nose, so must be the sinuses. So yes to all.
Last question. Hi. First, I wanted to touch on what Jill said about the octreotide, instant octreotide. I have constant headaches, and I just wanted to say, for anyone who has that, the octreotide helps instantly for that.
I hear that all the time, too.
And then I wanted to touch on what she was talking about, and other people have trigeminal nerve pain in the left side of my face, upper side. My nose is constantly congested, runs. My head itches horribly. My eye runs, and my jaw, the upper jaw hurts, and my ear is constantly stopped up. I'm on gabapentin for that. It doesn't help very long. Do you have any other recommendations for what might help with that?
Yeah, lots of other options.
Indomethacin
is an option. So just from this slide, indomethacin is an option. Certainly gabapentin, and you mentioned that you're on that. Lamotrigine, Lamictal, topiramate, melatonin can help with that. Nerve blocks, here's some other things. So galcanezumab or Emgality is 3 injections of that monoclonal antibody every month. And it's approved by the FDA for cluster headaches specifically, but I've used it in all of the trigeminal autonomic cephalgias and seen benefit. So there's lots and lots of options.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. And thank you for your speech.
Absolutely.